Hello. We're so glad to be gathered today, and we are excited about the conversation that's going to unfold. Thank you for taking the time to be here. This is a wonderful time for us to gather and just be in conversation. One of the great things about these virtual porches is that we're able to talk to a lot of people who have a lot of cool experiences and to learn and to grow and to be challenged. And we know and trust that you will feel that way today. I am so grateful that Shay Washington is here with us, is going to be helping to lead, and I'm going to let them introduce themselves to us here in a minute, but I'm grateful to Jim Waugh, who is a part of the Parents Reconciling Network, who has helped to kind of organize today, and also one of my colleagues, Helen Ride, is here on the call today, and they're going to have a moment of participation and sharing in the course of today's conversation. But you have come today to our virtual porch, and we are here to talk about not only the film Pray Away, which Shay will tell you a lot more about, but what it is talking about and how we as parents and allies and communities can utilize and respond to what Pray Away brings up for the queer and trans community specifically. So I'm so grateful, Shay. Thank you for giving your time and being with us in this season. And we would love it if you would introduce yourself and get us started with today's presentation. Thanks for being here, everybody.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Emily. I'm going to share my screen. Hopefully everyone can see that okay. I'm toggling a couple different screens, so I just want to make sure that I'll be able to advance all of the things. Okay. Yes, hello, good afternoon, good morning, good evening from wherever you are. Thank you so much for having me. It's really great to be here with all of y'all. Like Emily said, my name is Shay Washington. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. I am based in Northern Virginia, right outside of Washington, D.C. I was born in Cleveland, Ohio. I saw some fellow Buckeyes in the room. I also saw that we have some folks from D.C. So it's great to be here and get a chance to share this space with you all. Just a little bit more about me. I identify as a Black, queer, cis woman. I am a Christian with roots in the Black church, both AME and Baptist traditions, as well as spending many of my formative years in predominantly white evangelical church spaces, of which I am still recovering from today. I work as a consultant, an organizer, an educator, an artist, with faith-based and non-faith-based groups in connection with movement work for social change. So how do we advance change? How do we understand and recognize power and oppression in connection with our identities and the groups that we are a part of? How do we work to secure liberation for all people? And I'm so grateful that I get to lead the Impact campaign at Multitude Films, which is the film company that produced Pray Away, for the film Pray Away. I have a background in the performing arts, and I've often used it in connection with advancing social justice, but this has been my first time getting a chance to combine justice and film together, and it has been so life-giving for so many reasons. So let me just advance the slide. This workshop is called Narrative Strategy, Using Netflix's Pray Away as a Tool in Ending So-Called Conversion Therapy. Little introductions. This is me as a young child. Told you a little bit about myself. Great to see y'all here in the space. If you've seen the film or if you haven't, I'd love it if you would also put that in the chat. I know some of us have, or if you've even gotten a chance to come to one of the screening events that we've had, I'd love to know that. Okay, great. Some folks yes, some folks no. Awesome. Awesome. Okay. Great. Well, I want to start by just kind of playing the trailer to ground us all together. But before I do that, let me just offer this content advisement that the clip and the remainder of the workshop includes references to ex-LGBTQ teaching, conversion therapy, as well as homophobia, transphobia, acute and complex trauma, religious violence, and mental health issues like depression, anxiety, and self-harm. You know, I know that most folks in here are allies, but we also have folks who are part of the LGBTQ community here. Regardless of who you are, please just take care of yourself during this time. I hope you will stay, but if you need to leave, I totally understand that. If you need to mute the sound or turn off the video for a time, just, you know, encourage you to check in with yourself throughout this workshop and move how you need to move, okay? Right, so here comes the clip. This is the trailer.
I was active in the gay community for 13 years.
I was in it for 6 years, then struggled for 5 years before finding true freedom.
It was 13 years for me.
4 for me. We both walked away from it.
I personally came out of the homosexual lifestyle.
And we're just saying that if you want to change, there is a way to do it.
I spent a lot of time thinking, how did I believe that?
We were the leaders of the ex-gay movement. We believed that something must have happened to make you gay.
Parents are learning about a program called Exodus, which claims to convert gays.
We were promoting an idealized version of life. Gay people could be saved.
I became a figurehead for this movement. My role was to get the message out. Homosexuality was changeable. I ached to be loved and to love a man.
I went to my first Exodus conference when I was 17 years old. I remember feeling like this is the path to be good.
It was awful pseudo-psychology.
I started having panic attacks, the same-sex attractions. Those never went away.
We had guys that attempted suicide because they felt guilty that they couldn't change.
I'm looking at you. How does it feel to be growing from these empathies?
The voice inside me said, how could you do that to your own people?
There are new people taking up the torch.
I live transgender, and I left everything, follow the Lord.
Jesus, take this away from me.
There's so much shame.
We're killing ourselves by not embracing who God created us to be.
Lord, we want you back. I believe that something is being birthed out of you today. In Jesus' name, we thank you, Father. In Jesus' name.
Are you straight now? You're not a gay person who fights with yourself every day.
Right.
I was active in the gay community.
Okay. If you feel so inclined to just take a deep breath with me for a second and breathe out. Even just watching the trailer is a lot. I've seen this film multiple times because of leading this impact campaign and hosting community screenings across the country. And it is still a lot to take in. It's still difficult to watch. there's so much that can be said about the film. There's so much rich discussion to be had about the people that are profiled and the themes of the film and the movement, the ex-gay movement that it shows, how it is transitioning and the counter movement to it, which is what we're going to talk about today. But really what I want to make sure to do as we use this time is to look at how you can use this film in your own context to make change, right? When I talked to Emily, she said, you know, our folks are always looking for how do they make a difference? How can we really help? How can we really be an ally and impact change? And so using this film is one way to do that. So we're going to dive into that. I want to make sure that just to cover some key facts about conversion therapy before we dive into how you can use the film, just to make sure, you know, everyone has a base knowledge. And so I'll start with this conversion therapy, and you'll notice that we have it in quotes most oftentimes when you see it, because no one's being converted, right? It's not a true thing that is happening. The way that we have defined it is that conversion therapy is any attempt to change a person's sexual orientation or gender identity by a religious leader, licensed counselor, or in peer support groups. So I think it's important to recognize the word any, because these practices can look really different based off of your context, your culture, your community, where you're based. It can be an organized group like an Exodus or one of its offshoots that is meeting in a church, you know, routinely and has leaders and that sort of thing in a whole structure. It can just be a clergy person showing up at your house or calling you down to the altar to, you know, pray or have, you know, pray over someone for them to change. It can be a 12-step group. We had someone recently on our panel who talked about, you know, going to Liberty University and finding themselves in a Celebrate Recovery group that was completely geared to coercing folks into feeling that their gender identity, their sexual orientation was sinful, was broken, and needed to be changed. So this can look so vastly different, but any attempt to change someone's sexual orientation, gender identity, even gender presentation would fall into the realm of conversion therapy. It's also known as reparative therapy. It may also be referred to as ex-gay therapy or ministry. Other code words to look out for would be groups that mention sexual brokenness, gender confusion, unwanted same-sex attraction. These can all be words that can signal some sort of change effort program or tactic. There are nearly 700,000 people in the U.S. alone that have gone through some form of this. And this number will continue to grow. Conversion therapy is still being practiced today. It's happening most often in religious spaces, but even outside of religious spaces, according to a recent report that came out of UCLA, bless you, an estimated 20,000 LGBTQ minors in states that don't currently have protections will be subjected to conversion therapy by a licensed healthcare professional if states fail to act. So this is still so prominent. It's happening all over, and it's harming a lot of people. Research published in July 2020 showed that LGBTQ youth who underwent conversion therapy were more than twice as likely to report having attempted suicide and more than 2.5 times as likely to report multiple suicide attempts. Also, CT has been linked to things like depression, social withdrawal, substance abuse, issues with intimate relationships, high risk sexual behaviors, and loss of faith. According to Trevor Project's very recent national survey, they surveyed close to 34,000 LGBTQ youth ages 13 through 24, and 17% reported being threatened with or subjected to conversion therapy, including 1 in 5 transgender and non-binary youth, and more than 1 in 10 cisgender youth. You know, young people are calling Trevor's hotline all of the time, and they are hearing about conversion therapy. Young people fearing that they will be subjected to this, figuring out trying to navigate their identity, how to live their lives, but knowing that there aren't many protections for them. So again, this is still happening today. And it's just, you know, even I have learned so much, you know, just through leading this campaign, how prominent this is. And for youth especially, but not even just young people, so many adults are still participating and being subjected to these programs. And, you know, it's interesting, one of the people that we had on our panel recently was saying that there's really no way, even as an adult sometimes, to really feel like there is a way to consent to these programs, because the leaders are telling you that your soul essentially is hanging in the balance, right? And oftentimes it's also so tied up with belonging. And so how can there be any sort of just relationship or way to participate in something like this? There's really not. And so there's so many factors and harm to be considered on multiple levels. So before I continue, I do just want to pause and see, Helen, if you would like to just offer anything about your experience.
Sure. Good to be with everybody. My name is Helen Ride, and my pronouns are they, them. I'm excited to be here with Shay. Shay and I have known each other for a long time. Gosh, that's a little close to camera there, like, whoa.
You look great.
Moving back. So yeah, Shay and I met in, I think, 2014. I'm terrible with years, but anyway, we've known each other a while, so I'm really pleased to be able to do this with you all today. So conversion therapy, I'm glad, Shay, that you said that conversion therapy can look really different. You know, it's not a sort of one single experience. I think oftentimes people might think of conversion therapy as a residential experience where people go away for a period of time and, you know, a residential program. And that's not what I experienced. I also experienced it as a young adult. So I wasn't a teenager. When I was a teenager, I wasn't really in churches that were non-affirming. And honestly, I wasn't really clear enough about who I was at that point. But once I did figure out that I was queer and I was in non-denominational evangelical charismatic churches in the UK, and I think I've always thought of UK Christians, fundamentalist Christians, as they're sort of a sort of softer, kinder, gentler version of conversion therapy. But the impact is the same. It's still really harmful. So I experienced, when I first came out to my pastor, I was at a church in London, and I would have been, I think, 19 or 20. And it was made very clear that that what I was telling them about myself was not okay, and that I needed to get help. So that first round consisted of sort of prayer and conversation with some members of the church who honestly didn't have the faintest idea what they were doing. They weren't at all experienced in any of that, but the sense was that I needed to pray to change myself. That was the clear message. And really I cycled through different iterations of that with different levels of intensity for the next 13 or 14 years. And I would, for me, the way it worked out was I would sort of go through some counseling and prayer and stuff like that and feel like things maybe were okay. And then I fall in love with another girl. It was just tragic. And so then I go back to my pastors. I moved churches at one point down to Canterbury. And then there was more prayer and more counseling and therapy. They called it therapy. It wasn't really therapy. But at every point, it was, you're not okay. You need to change. God can change you. You just need to work harder, pray harder, believe more, and the change will come. And it's soul destroying. I didn't see it as soul destroying at the time. At the time, I saw it as a faithful response to what I thought God required of me. And I think that's the other thing that's really damaging, is that all of this is seated in that sort of your acceptability to God, or your legitimacy as a Christian, the degree of your commitment to your faith is all predicated upon how you're approaching trying to change your sexuality or orientation. There were books that were read. I did go to some conferences. The Living Waters program by Andy Kaminsky was doing conferences in the UK at that time, and I went to one of those. At one point, people in my church performed an exorcism over me, you know, and, you know, prayed the demons out of me. And so I can talk about it fairly, you know, dispassionately at this point. It was a long time ago. But at the time, it was just a relentless effort to try and change who God had made me to be. And eventually, over time, I was waking up to the fact that it wasn't changing me. You know, the cycle was just repeating itself. Rinse, repeat, rinse, repeat, rinse, repeat. And I made a decision to stop trying to change myself. And I then moved to America, which, as I say, is not required. If you want to stop conversion therapy, you don't have to move across an ocean, but it worked for me. And, you know, eventually landed in the United Methodist Church after several years away from it, and proceeded on a lengthy, and when I say lengthy, I mean years and years and years of unraveling the messages in your mind and your brain around faith and God and what it means to be a Christian. And don't underestimate that. There's the harm of the process of trying to change. And then there's the period of time, once you've decided to stop changing, there's the period of time of then unscrambling all the nonsense that's been in your brain. And I will tell you, I was, in fact, honestly, it was during the time that Shay and I first met, I was already working for RMN. I was already working for LGBTQ inclusion in the United Methodist Church. And I was still hearing the voice in my head. Oh, but Helen, you might have got it wrong. Oh, but Helen, what if you're wrong? And what if you're leading people away, you know, away from God? I had that sort of bugging noise in my voice, in my brain. That didn't stop, you know, probably till 2015, maybe. And even now, there are days when I still hear that voice, and I have to remind myself of all the new things that I've learned and what I believe. I guess that says enough probably, but I'm grateful for this film. I hope it helps people understand the harm that is done, and that I believe it's a great teaching tool. I think we have to handle it carefully. I think Shay already mentioned that at the beginning. This is a tender topic, and it's not for everybody, but for allies especially, I think learning the harm and being able to speak to that and to work against this this conversion therapy is still really important. Is that okay, Shay?
Is that okay? Yeah.
I wasn't sure. I was kind of ad-libbing, as you know, but if people have questions after the fact and they want to, I'll put my email in the chat. If people want to have follow-up conversation or have questions, I'm more than happy to do and help with that. So
Thank you so much, Helen. Thank you for sharing that, your story. I think soul destroying couldn't have put it more profoundly. And also what strength and perseverance, right? And love, like the power there that is demonstrated in your story to still be here, still be pressing forward, and the work that you're doing to advance affirmation and inclusion is so important. And yet, you know, I hear you, like that the voice can still be there. It takes so much to deprogram, uncondition, unlearn, and relearn different beliefs about who we are and who we've been created to be. And conversion therapy just works so much against that. So thank you so much for that. You know, I'll go back to sharing my screen, and, you know, I want to offer that there is good news to be shared. And the good news is that this can be stopped. It is possible. There are people all of the time, just like, you know, Helen's story, walking away and realizing, okay, I'm not changing. This isn't God's design for me. The way that, you know, the core of who I am is fine. There are organizations and legislators and all of these things happening. Conversion therapy practices can be stopped. It's going to take all of us. It really will take everyone getting involved, figuring out what you can do, what your sphere of influence is, who you can be talking to, how you can be showing up as a vocal, invisible ally. All major medical and mental health associations have denounced the practice as harmful, including the American Psychological Association, the American Psychiatric Association, and basically every other professional health organization. There is also a robust state-by-state movement underway to pass legislation to protect LGBTQ youth from conversion therapy as practiced by licensed professional counselors. There is a wonderful website, the Movement Advancement Project, where you can search this issue and a host of others and figure out where your state stands. If your state has a ban, has a partial ban, is pursuing legislation towards that. And right now there are over 20 US states and territories that do have bans. Here is the caveat. The bans are a critical component of ending conversion therapy. And yet, even as they are passed, the majority of where this practice happens will continue to be religious institutions, which are constitutionally shielded from the legislation due to religious freedom laws. And so it's essential that in addition to the bans, that there is work being done to impact hearts and minds, to counter the false belief that anything LGBTQ is a sign of brokenness, sinfulness, an evil spirit, and can thus be left behind or prayed away. Changing people's hearts and minds are so important, right? We know that laws, we've seen it, can revert. And so we champion the bans. We want them to continue happening. But really what we want to do is figure out, how do we impact people to really understand this issue fundamentally in their hearts so that we keep moving forward? So that is where this impact campaign and you come in. So just really quickly, impact producing is kind of relatively new. It's a specific role in connection with documentary films that have a specific mission and message and want to affect change, whether that's, raising awareness, inspiring action, changing policy. These are a few films that have utilized impact producing in an impact campaign. It was really important to us to complement the national strategy that's happening regarding the bans, and to support that, to come alongside and support that, to figure out how do we impact people, how do we equip folks, specifically folks of faith, to respond vocally, publicly, effectively in support of their LGBTQ plus loved ones and community members. What is it that can sustain the legislative effort? It's the heart and mind change, right? For helping folks think and feel differently about the issues themselves. A huge reason why CT is able to continue operating is because most folks think it's a thing of the past, or they're only thinking about it in connection with some of the more physically violent forms, such as electroshock therapy, or more overt groups, like Helen was saying, you know, being sent away to a camp or some sort of program. You know, oftentimes folks are not considering the recovery group at the church next door that they could be promoting and carrying out tactics in connection with conversion or reparative therapy. Currently, we have hosted screenings in Atlanta, in Austin, in Oklahoma City, in Fort Worth. We will be wrapping up this campaign in the beginning of next year, and we're planning for several more screenings, Dallas, Birmingham, Orlando, Chicago, and Washington, D.C. If you are in those areas and want to be a part, please get in contact with me. I'd love to have you either on the planning team or in the audience or on the panel. With each screening, we are looking to localize the film. You know, this is a big issue. It's happening globally, but when we do the screenings, we're really wanting to help folks understand how it's being carried out in their area and the work that's being done to stop it and how they can be a part of that. We want to increase accessibility, prompt community discussions, provide resources, and really help folks who are already who would already say we stand against this, to be able to mobilize together and actually take action. We also are hoping that for folks who, you know, maybe they don't know about this, and so they haven't been a vocal ally because they don't really understand that this is still happening and the harm that it causes, we also want to bring them into the fold and give them a place to take action for change. One of the things that we share at every screening is that regardless of where you stand theologically, in connection with LGBTQ relationships, you can be a vocal advocate against conversion therapy. It is in line with your faith, regardless of your theology. The harm that this causes is something that your faith compels you to stand against. So parents are important, really want you to like accentuate that parents are so important in the work for change. You can really have an impact. According to Trevor Project, having at least one accepting adult can reduce the risk of a suicide attempt among LGBTQ young people by 40%. So parents, other adults, just affirming people, be a vocal and visible ally. Let your community know where you stand. And there's multiple ways that you can do that. Consider all of your circles of influence, right? So you've got you here in the center. Who are you connected to? LGBTQ youth, other parents, family and friends, your church community, educators, elected officials, your neighbors, your coworkers, who are people that you could be having conversations with about this issue, sharing the film with them, talking about your own experience, right, of coming to understand this issue and how it impacted you, and the stories that you've heard, to really move things along. We have been so grateful to have parent groups partner with us on this campaign, like Free Mom Hugs and Mama Bears and PFLAG. We've had some awesome parents on our panel, including author and speaker Jen Hatmaker. She's right here in the very center of this program with the white pants on. One of the things that she said when I asked her, you know, what she wanted to share with other parents was this quote right here. She said, "Don't be afraid of these hard questions. Press in and press hard. Don't just leave this to your feelings or what you've always been told. Study. There are other ways to interpret these scriptures. Lean in like your kids' lives depend on it, because it does." So that I thought was just so powerful, and I wanted to share that here. I think everyone here is already on board with that, but you know, being able to just continue to tell other parents and other adults, it's so important to press in and to, you know, make it known where you stand, because people are watching, even when you don't realize it. Young people are watching, other folks are watching, and they're looking to know that they can safely be themselves with you and around you. So how do you do it? How do you host your own grassroots screening? I don't know, kind of pop culture references and the age range in the room, but Montel Jordan was big when I was growing up, and he had a song that said, "This is how you do it." So we just put that in there for it. So how do you do it? Anyone can host their own screening. Because of the educational license that Multitude Films was intentional to get for this film, anyone can host their own screening. There are a couple terms, including that the film needs to be streamed through Netflix. So that would be someone having a Netflix account who would log into their account and then be able to share their screen or gather around in the same space together. You can't charge for it or solicit donations. You can't use Netflix's logos. They call it a one-time screening, but it doesn't mean that you can only, you know, share it one time. They just don't want you, you know, doing it over and over and sort of having any sort of monetary gain from it. But pretty much if you have a Netflix account or know someone who does, you can host your own screening. It doesn't have to be fancy, right? You can gather people where you live or in a clubhouse or in a room, projector outside, whatever. Get some people, maybe have some snacks and have some discussion afterwards. We have a great discussion guide on our website that I'll be sure to share with you all. It's got some great questions to walk you through how to ask and how to discuss the themes in the film. So it doesn't have to be fancy, or it can be, right? If you want it to, if you want to have more of a public gathering, we'd encourage you to, again, work to localize the film. Consider just the ways that Pray Away is relevant in your community. For some settings, it might be appropriate to point towards current advocacy efforts. For others, it will make sense to make it more about personal stories. Just, you know, kind of figure out what your goals are and how you want to localize it. We invite you to assemble a team so that you're not holding all of this, all of the logistics yourself. And just kind of, you know, think about your goals. Again, are you working to, you know, get signatures in petition, in support of a coalition working in your city or your state to pass a ban? Are you interested in generating interest to offer public comment during a city council or state legislative votes? There's so many things that you can do. You could also host a screening that is geared to being a more intimate event for survivors. If you're a survivor, excuse me, and you want to create space for reflection or lament or healing, or for parents, you know, there are a lot of parents who need safe spaces to process and heal in connection with their involvement, you know, with maybe putting their young person, their child into one of these programs, thinking that it was what was best for them at the time, thinking that they were loving them, not realizing the detrimental harm that has come, that would come through that. Those spaces are important. They should be done, apart from, like, you can't, not holding those spaces, with other LGBTQ folks, because that's placing an undue burden on that community. But for parents to be able to gather and process, much like you do here, that would be another way that you could use the film. Just a couple more things that I'll point out. It's, if you are going to have a panel discussion, I highly recommend scripting it a little bit. So interviewing or talking with ahead of time the people that you're going to talk to just find out the key points of their story, that they're comfortable highlighting and sharing and crafting questions around that. The film is long itself, and so being able to get to some pointed questions is really important. We have found that discussions about the film are best when they actually aren't about the film itself or the protagonists in them, but about you and your context and what's going on there. And then the last thing that I'll say from this is just consider the spiritual care and the mental health connections in advance. We always have a care team on hand, folks who have experience. They don't necessarily have to be therapists or clergy, but they can be. They can also be someone from a parent group who has experience just listening, providing a supportive ear, being able to connect people with resources if things come up while they're watching the film. We've got some great resources to support you in this. We've got a mental health guide. We've got a discussion guide. I also really encourage you, if you haven't checked out the Good Fruit Project, this is a resource that was made in partnership with the Trevor Project and Q Christian Fellowship to provide a counter to the changed movement coming out of Bethel, saying that folks can change. This is the group Good Fruit Project, which provides a faith-based case against conversion therapy. So check that out. So just in summation, CT can be stopped. It will take all of us. Change is really, really possible. At the end of the film, one of the former leaders of Exodus says that as long as homophobia exists, some form of, you know, Exodus will emerge, some form of conversion therapy, will happen. And so this process of change is so important, impacting people's hearts and minds, to really remember that who we are is beautiful, right? That we are fearfully and wonderfully made, and that no one should be made to feel that something is fundamentally broken or wrong about them. So please feel free. I'll open it now for any questions or reflections. My email is here if you want to reach out and contact me. I'd love to figure out how to be in support of the good work that y'all are doing. And I think that's it. Thank you so much.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Shay, for all of that good information. And several people have already asked in the chat, just wanting to make sure that they could get some of those good resources that you were referring us to. And so I will definitely reconnect with you and send a follow-up email that will have both the recording of this presentation as well as some of those resources outlined out for you to consider. Shay, I'm just so grateful for this effort in conjunction with the film. What a beautiful way to help make the impact larger and wider. I know that many people said that they've already seen the film, which is wonderful. So I hope that you're already thinking about what might in furthering this conversation in my community look like. But before we get done today, Shay has offered to answer any questions that that you may have. Is there anybody that would, you're welcome to come off a mute, or if you want to put it in the chat, if there's anything that you would like to say or ask during this time. I think that people are finding that map really interesting. I can tell that a couple of people have already gone to look to see what's going on in their own state. So thank you for that. Are there any other resources similar to the map, but that are good to go for state regulations or, you know, laws or bans that are in process in places that you're aware of, Shay?
Trevor Project has great resources, and then also Born Perfect, which is a program of NCLR. They work, they're really leading, NCLR is the National Center for Lesbian Rights. They're really leading the legislative work to go state by state and get these bans passed. And so definitely check out their website and their work.
Okay, great, thank you.
I wanted to do a shout out for the Good Fruit Project that Shay mentioned. The thing that finally silenced the voice in my head was the fact of the fruit. What is the fruit of conversion therapy versus what is the fruit of affirming theology? And so that website is really, really helpful.
Awesome. I'm not seeing any questions pop up. So Shay, do you have any closing thoughts that you want to offer in?
No, I'm just dropping Born Perfect and the Good Fruit Project. And Emily, I know you'll send these out too.
That's perfect. Yeah, that's great. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Well, you've given us a lot to think about. And I hope that all of us on this call hear this as a call to action and an invitation. As Shay and I were talking and doing some preparing and thinking about ways that reconciling ministries could be a part of this project, but the work, you know, that it needs to extend beyond it when it comes to policy and change. You know, it is a balance between change in legislation and laws. But as we all know, as Helen and I were just on some phone calls yesterday talking about this reality, is that just because you change a law doesn't mean that people's hearts and minds are changed. And that's the work that we are called to be about as people of God, as people who affirm the lives of queer and trans folks. And so I hope that you hear that there is a lot of work to be done. Your mind may already be in a space of affirmation. And yet I know that we're all connected with folks who could use someone to come alongside and have conversation and lead into the bigger picture of what changes need to happen in and around our communities. So thank you again, Shay, for helping to bring this to us as a possibility for us to engage further, utilizing the good work of Pray Away, but talking about what's happening in our local communities. That's what we all want to be engaged with. Eric, I see your hand up. Do you want to?
Yeah, first, a huge thank you to Shay and to Helen and to you, Emily, and the group that brought this together. I think one of the reasons, no questions right away, this was just for us, it was just overwhelming. And with, you know, as you were talking about all the possibilities of sharing this with other groups, and that was going through my mind. And we haven't yet seen the film. So, I mean, that's just based on the discussion here and the clips. That was, and I think someone else mentioned it in chat, when, you know, California is one of those states that has a ban on conversion therapy, but I did not think about the idea that, well, it's still going on in churches for the reasons, you know, religious freedom and all that. So much work to be done. But thank you for taking this lead in this area. This was great.
One question I have is I'm wondering about how many churches or denominations actually have come out and denounced, you know, in their, you know, bylaws or whatever, this conversion therapy. I would be curious to know, you know, anything from the Catholic Church, Baptist, Presbyterians, some of the, you know, more mainstream churches, you know, what kind of language they have put out there about, you know, conversion therapy and their policies toward that. I'd be curious to know that.
Yeah, that's a great question. Yeah, something I'd love to look more into as well. Yeah, because there definitely is language out there. I also do think that this is, you know, even for affirming denominations aren't always thinking about this issue in the forefront of their minds. And so I think that there is still so much work to be done there, but I will look into that.
That is a great question. Thank you. Well, again, we thank you all for taking the time to be here. We are here, and Shay has offered to be a resource in the midst of the continuing conversation as well. We appreciate that. But please stay in touch. And as you have questions or thoughts, we are partners alongside you in this work of inclusion and justice. Shay, grateful for the role that you play in elevating the conversation and getting us all to think further and deeper. So thank you again for this shared time together. It's the season of Advent. You may have been in spaces of lighting candles. I just pray that your lives are surrounded by hope and peace and justice and joy in this season. Know that God is with you, within you, and around you at all times. And we're grateful for who you are and your role and work in this ministry of reconciliation and peace and justice to come to all of God's people. So take that as a word of peace and love in this season, and we hope to gather with you again soon. Take care, everybody. Thanks for joining us today. Bye-bye.